हरि वी प्रे द ऑलमाइटी फॉर अ फुलफिलिंग लर्निंग एक्सपीरियंस। शङ्करूपेण मच्चित्तं पङ्कीकृतमभूद्यया किङ्करीयशसा माया शङ्कराचार्यमाश्रये शास्त्रं शरीरमीमांसा देवस्तु परमेश्वरः आचार्याः शङ्कराचार्याः संतु मे जन्म जन्मनि। ध्यानमूलं गुरोर्मूर्तिः पूजामूलं गुरोः पदं मंत्रमूलं गुरोर्वाक्यं मोक्षमूलं गुरोः कृपा। न माता पिता वा न देवा न लोक न वेदा न यज्ञा न तीर्थं ब्रुवन्ति सुषुप्तौ निरस्ताति शून्यात्मकत्वात् तदेकोऽवशिष्टः शिवः केवलोऽहम् तदेकोऽवशिष्टः शिवः केवलोऽहम् शिवः केवलोऽहम् शिवः केवलोऽहम् शिवः केवलोऽहम्। हरिः ओम् श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः। एट् द औट्सेट् लेट् अस् आल् प्रोफ्यूस्लि थैंक अवर आचार्यजी श्री सच्चिदानंद सरस्वती जी फॉर टेकिंग अस थ्रू द स्पिरिचुअल जर्नी विद द टूल ऑफ दशश्लोकी। इन द प्रीवियस वीक्स ही हैज टॉट अस द फर्स्ट टू वर्सेस ऑफ दशश्लोकी अपार्ट फ्रॉम द वेदांत कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ निर्वाण अहंकार ममकार एंड द लाइक। Today, he is going to take up the third slokam of the Dashashloki and explain us the details. Before that, Acharyaji has explained certain important basic Vedanta concepts for our foundation. We will be continuing our exploration of the Dashashloki. Swamiji has started with recapitulation of the first two verses, having been melodiously recited by him. Dashashloki is a very profound and advanced text of Vedanta to be studied after completing the study of Upanishads. This text gives us an entire vision of Vedanta. The other approach is, well, we need to know the ultimate first and then start our sadhana from the basics to attain the ultimate. That is what we are doing. Explore from the basics and complete the understanding of the ultimate. The ultimate goal is discovering the ananda within oneself by oneself. For all the students of Vedanta, moksha or freedom is the goal. This freedom is very different than the economic freedom, geographic freedom, political freedom, and the like. Here, the freedom from dukkha. Dukkha essentially means freedom from samsara, from the cycle of unending desires and the pursuits for becoming. Spirituality is to discover this freedom from a life of becoming to a life of being. All becomings are outer explorations. We need to explore the inner freedom. This is the Adhyayana, this is the Adhyatma, and this is the Adhyayana Bharati for. So, some concepts of basic Vedanta. What are the basic qualifications for Vedanta have to be well understood. To study Vedanta, just like any other discipline, specific qualifications are essential. Shankaracharya ji has given these qualifications as fourfold and called them as sadhana chatushtayam. Chatushta meaning four. Four qualifications, essential ingredients for Vedanta study. The first one of them is viveka. It is the ability to separate from the real, the unreal, the temporary from the permanent. Example, mirage is an optical illusion. The reality is no water. The unreality is apparently perceiving water. Real, permanent has to be understood in contrast to the unreal. Ultimate viveka is the ability to discriminate between atma and anatma. Here, the words real and unreal are replaced by atma and anatma. As student of Vedanta, as we move forward, we understand that atma is the real and anatma is the unreal. Dasyasloki is an attempt to arrive at the real after negating the unreal. Unreal does not mean that it does not physically exist. The apparent nature only is pointed out. For example, gold and ornament. Gold is real and its appearance as jewel is unreal. Body is anatma and the real entity is the consciousness within. Tube light is an appearance and the invisible electricity inside is the real. Atma is the electricity which powers the light bulb, and the light bulb here is the body. Light bulb has no real existence of utility independent of the electricity. This is about Viveka. The second qualification for Vedanta study is Vairagya. Means dispassion. Raga means passion or attachment. Viraga or Vairagya is dispassion or non-attachment. We need the sense of Vairagya or dispassion in order to understand Vedanta. If we were to be so attached to the body, house, possessions, etc., we will never understand the ultimate reality. For example, a scientist who wants to examine the real composition of an object, he cannot be attached to it. He has to make an objective analysis of it, coming out of it, to know its reality. We have to be dispassionate and separate ourselves from the body to analyze our true nature. This ability not to have passion or attachment is Vairagya. The third qualification is Mumukshutvam. Moktum Ichhami Mumuksha. Tasya Bhavaha Mumukshutvam. Means the desire or intense longing to discover freedom within and the absolute happiness without this end. Without mumukshutvam or this intense yearning or longing, any study is just acquiring knowledge and embellishing us, not experiencing the reality. Knowing Vedanta as a subject after intense study is no use in spiritual life. If it is coupled with mumukshutva, then it will bear fruit. Then comes Samadhi Shatka Sampatti, a set of six qualifications, six subdivisions in the fourth one. We shall study them in our next class. A quick recap of the Vedantic terms that are explained today: Viveka, the ability to discriminate Atma from the Anatma, or the real from the unreal, or the permanent from the temporary. Dispassion towards objects, people, experiences is Vairagya. Mumukshatvam is intense longing our desire for freedom and to realize the ultimate truth. And the fourth one is Sama, etc., set of six practices which will be taught in the next week. So, just to recapitulate, in the first verse, Acharya Swamiji has separated our real nature from the Panchabhutas, which are the part of Anatma. Na bhumir na toyam na tejo na vayu na kam nendriyam va na tesham samuhaha. In the second verse, Acharya ji further separated from the social constraints or social labels we have, like the varna, the varnashrama, the do's and do nots, the dharma, and also the yoga sadhanas, etc. All these sadhanas are very much essential until we realize the ultimate. But Acharya ji separated the Atma from all the sadhanas. All the tools are required to connect the electric bulb to electricity. But once it is done, these instruments are of no use. We do not need them anymore. Likewise, the very important steps of sadhana also terminate in the realization. So now, coming to the third verse, Na mata na pitava. The first phrase is Namata. My real nature is not the motherhood or the fatherhood. This is a very important social label, very difficult to let go. Throughout our lifetime, we feel we are these social labels, mother and father, etc. Motherhood is very sacred and powerful, but yet, in spirituality, we have to separate the motherhood and fatherhood from the Atma. These are the roles to be played very wisely and properly and take all the responsibilities associated with them. After that, the role is successfully finished. All the duties are done towards children. These roles are necessary for outer world. They are not for the inner exploration. The word Kripana, as used in Bhagavad Gita by Bhagavan Sri Krishna, means a miser. Who is a miser? A person who has not explored the inner world is a miser. He keeps on exploring only the outer world. Kripana or stingy person has little knowledge about the inner world. We have to keep aside these roles also. Whatever father, mother, banker, doctor, student, teacher, these roles are in our worldly life, have to be given up to explore the inner world. Even on the seat of meditation, we notice we are not able to let go of these roles. This is our general experience. We have to separate ourselves from these roles, and these roles are temporary and relative. Same is the understanding for all the roles like father, etc. Then the next phrase is Na Deva. The effulgent beings, the superpowers, are the Devas. Devas in nature, like Vayu Devata, Varuna Devata, Bhu Devata, Surya Devata, etc. This is a very bold statement and important too. I am not interested in acquiring or getting the boons of these devatas. That is what Acharya is saying. These are Adhidaivika pursuits, not in Adhyatmika or inner exploration. We are exploring pure consciousness, and in the process, we have nothing to do with the outer explorations and Adhidaivikas. Of course, we do require the blessings of the Devatas in order to even study Adhyatma. Several people do upasanas of different Devatas to gain or harness the Siddhis. Acharya is pointing out that these pursuits are of no use for Atma Vidya or Adhyatma study. So we are not interested in Vedanta, in Devatas or their powers. The story of Bhasmasura is narrated. He obtained several special powers worshipping the Devatas. Those very powers have annulled him. So these powers are finite, limited and temporary, and a student of Vedanta is not after them, not interested in any of these occult powers. Then Naloka, not interested in higher lokas. In Sanatana Dharma, it is believed that various types of merit beget various higher lokas. Actually, it is not the Atma which travels towards the lokas, but the Sukshma Sarira or the Karana Sarira travels to the lokas. There are seven upper worlds and seven lower worlds. This list is also given by Swamiji for completion. A person who has lot of Punya Karma, he is put in the Svarga Loka. This is like a visa. Until the merit lasts, the study in that loka may be possible. Once the merits are exhausted, Kshine Punye Matya Lokam Vishanti, as in Kathopanishad or Bhagavad Gita, the person has to come back to his home. This is what Shankaracharya ji exclaims in Punarapi Jananam, Punarapi Maranam. This is the cycle of transmigration, births and deaths. We are not interested in the lokas either. In spirituality, we are raising above all these beliefs of lokas and devas, etc. Lokas and devas are mentioned here not to acquire the powers or those positions, but to negate them. Na Veda, not even the Vedas. A very, very bold statement indeed. The Vedas, as a body of knowledge, are the tools to know the Atma Tattva. Having fulfilled their purpose, a sadhaka having reached the self-realization, there is no more role left for the Vedas, which are the tools. This is from the ultimate standpoint, not from our perspective. Na Veda means I have no more dependence on the Vedas also, after having reached the ultimate. We know there are four Vedas, Rig, Yajus, Sama and Atharvana Vedas. In Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, there appears a mantra which says, Yatra Veda Aveda Bhavanti. The Veda itself negates Veda. Veda also becomes Aveda. That is the state of ultimate realization. That is the enlightenment. And it does not depend on study of Vedas anymore at that stage. In the traditional sannyasa, the guru cuts the yajnopavitam of the disciple. This is symbolic of severing the connection with the Vedas or all the ritualistic karmakanda of the Vedas. For the sannyasin, the part of Veda, the ritual part, has no import. No restrictions are placed on the sannyasi. No acharya dharmas of the Vedas are any more tenable for the sannyasi. Here this is not to underplay the importance of Vedas. Then comes the word na yajna. No dependence on the sacrificial rites or the yajnas. As we go higher in spirituality, the religious rituals have to fall off, have to be given up. This ultimate realization is like standing on the top of a mountain of Atma Jnana and looking at the tiny things below, like the yajnas, the karmas, the acharas, the duties, the vyavaharas, the roles, etc. When one is experiencing the absolute bliss on the mountain top, these have no more meaning, because the person is now I realized one, Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam, Brahma. The sadhaka is now on the pinnacle of enlightenment or on the summit of that mountain of Atma Jnana. He is proclaiming that state of Nirvana, the freedom or the bliss. So, we have to understand the ultimate experience in this way and start our journey of understanding and studying intensely Bhagavad Gita, Upanishads, etc. These scriptures and yajnas are negated from the standpoint of the realized soul, not from our viewpoint. In the worldly life and in the journey towards the essential, these are required. Then, na tirtham, sacred places. Tirtham means sacred places. Several people are desirous of visiting religious places, rivers, etc. because we believe that God is present in those sacred places only, and we forget to explore our inner tirtham. In Bhagavata Purana, there is a story which says, idam tirtham, idam tirtham, idam tirtham, saying, this is a sacred place, this also is a sacred place, this too is a sacred place. Keeps on telling this way. But that person has never taken a dip in his inner tirtham. Acharyaji, pointing inward, has said that the real tirtham is here. We never explore the inner tirtham, which is the Hridayakasha. So, for the sadhaka, for me the outer tirthams are irrelevant. That is the statement when we say na tirtha. So, na mata, pitava, na deva, na loka, na yajna, na tirtham, bravanti. Bravanti means it is proclaimed, it is said, they said so. It is declared by the man of wisdom. The next two lines of the third sloka in Dasa Sloki will be discussed next week. The explanation and the teaching given by Acharyaji is very simple, lucid and clear. We all immensely thank him for the time and the interest he is having to teach us in such a blissful manner. We thank the Almighty and Shankaracharya ji for making us part of the study of Vedanta. We meet next week. Hari Om. Na mata pitava, na deva, na loka, na veda, na yajna, na tirtham bruvanti. सुषुप्तौ निरस्ताति शून्यात्मकत्वात् तदेकोऽवशिष्टः शिवः केवलोऽहम् तदेकोऽवशिष्टः शिवः केवलोऽहम् शिवः केवलोऽहम् शिवः केवलोऽहम् शिव केवलो